Happy New Year. We're so happy to have you. Although we're all online though, but we're so happy and we should just continue to be grateful and continue to praise God, and hopefully it gets better, but that's why we have God and we just keep praying. Please join us as we sing the hymn song.
Again, let's go to the Lord in prayer. O Lord, our God in ages past, and our hope for years to come, and our shelter from the stormy blast in our eternal home. Lord, we come before you this morning, especially purposely to praise and adore you. We praise you, for you are worthy. Lord, we come before you to say you are holy, you are mighty, you are worthy, worthy of all our praises. So with our voices, Lord, we say thank you for marvelous things you have done for us. And we also say, Ebenezer, you have brought us to this far. With gratitude in our heart, Lord, we thank you for everything you have done. We thank you for everything you are doing. And we thank you for everything you will be doing in our lives. We reach a new year. And in human perspective, Lord, we will say we have suffered many trials, suffering, anxieties and anguish, but you said you have made everything beautiful in your time. And you also said we should give thanks in every circumstances. So God, we give thanks for all what you have done. In our years ahead, Lord, is in your hand. Because in you we live, we move, and we have our being. And without you, Lord, we are nothing. Lord, we lift up our congregation, our sisters and brothers who are suffering with one another by the new pandemic. You are the great healer. You are the great comforter. Lord, we ask you to stretch up your holy hand to bring healing to them, O God. We pray for our preacher this morning. Lord, you speak to him as he speaks to us. And let each word and his meditation be acceptable unto you. And we, congregation, Lord, we ask you to give us an ear to hear, eyes to see, and heart to obey. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
The visit of the Magi, as recorded in Matthew chapter 2. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be comforted because they are no more. But when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, "Rise, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead." And he rose and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. And he went and lived in a city called Nazareth, so that what was spoken by the prophet might be fulfilled, that he would be called a Nazarene.
May we also learn and make that personal decision where we are ready to worship God and worship him with joy unending. Please stand as we sing, Shine Jesus Shine.
Truth, you're now being shined on. Good morning. Tim Melton, our pastor, is taking a day of vacation, and so he has asked me, I am Keith Morris, to preach in his stead. And I would comment, I am occasionally invited to speak by Tim. But Tim does this every Sunday, and he does a fantastic job. And besides that is his care for the church. So let's remember Tim in prayer and in thanksgiving as we celebrate today. Christmas, as we know it, wouldn't be complete without the story of the visit of the Magi. Matthew 2:1 begins the story saying, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews?' According to tradition, the arrival of the Magi is celebrated on January 6th. The church liturgical calendar calls January 6th Epiphany, or divine appearing. And the Merriam-Webster dictionary defines Epiphany as that day, January 6th, observed as a church festival in commemoration of the coming of the Magi as the first manifestation of Christ to the Gentiles. Isaiah prophesied about the universal impact and scope of the Messiah's appearing in Isaiah 49:5-6. And now says the Lord, it is too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also make you a light of the nations, so that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. It has forever been God's purpose to redeem all of mankind, both Jews and Gentiles. The Magi were among those Gentiles upon whom the light of the Lord's advent shone. And according to tradition, there were three Magi, probably because the scripture tells us they brought three gifts. And from tradition, their names were, you know them, Balthasar, Melchior, and Gaspar. From the depictions in the Belenes of Spain, we have the impression that they arrived to worship the newborn babe in the manger along with the shepherds from the hills of Bethlehem. But the Bible tells us in Matthew 2, verse 11, that when they found the babe and his mother, it was in a house and not in the manger. So it's as today's scripture says in verse 1 that the Magi arrived in Jerusalem after the Christ was born. The biblical story differs from tradition in other details. The Bible doesn't tell us how many Magi there were. It doesn't tell us their names. It doesn't tell us from which country they came. The Bible doesn't tell us how the Magi knew of the star or how they knew the star was a celestial sign of the birth of the King of the Jews. Verse 1 continues, in the days of Herod the king. Now, Herod was not a Jew. He was an Edomite. He was of Edomite and Arabic descent. He had been appointed king of the Jews and of Judah by the Romans and had now reigned nearly 34 years. He was about 70 years old at the time of Christ's birth. It continues, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem. The Magi of Scripture were men of learning who specialized in the study of astronomy, astrology, and probably the natural sciences. These men were possibly royalty, possibly royal astrologers, or even noblemen. Some prophetic scriptures have led us to consider the Magi as kings. Isaiah 60, verses 3 and 6 say, nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. All those from Sheba will come. They will bring gold and frankincense and will bear good news of the praises of the Lord. Actually, nothing is known about the Magi. The story is not about them, but about Jesus Christ. Their being included is only in so much as they came to worship Him. Having mentioned that Magi in the days of Jesus were astronomers and astrologers, I must say there is nothing wrong with astronomy. The study of the planets, the stars, galaxies, and nebulas that fill the universe. God actually said, "Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these stars, the one who leads forth their hosts by number. He calls them all by name. Because of the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one of them is missing." But the Christian must not dabble in fortune-telling, astrology, or the horoscope. These are practices, ancient practices, of divination that seek guidance and counsel from the movements of the planets and stars, rather than seeking guidance and counsel from God who made the heavens and from His Word. Astrology and the horoscope constitute an alternative religious system incompatible with Christian faith. Leviticus says you shall not practice divination or soothsaying. They are strictly forbidden by God for His people. Don't dabble in astrology or the horoscope. Don't look at them. Burn them. Instead, interpret experience and seek guidance and counsel from Scripture, from God's Word. It says in Colossians, "In Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Continuing in verse 1, the Magi came from the east. The passage doesn't give us the location or city from which the Magi started their trip. Directly east of Jerusalem and Judea is the Syro-Arabian desert. And beyond the desert, along the fertile crescent of the Euphrates and Tigris rivers, were in that time the civilizations of the Medes, the Persians, and the Babylonians. That would be modern-day Iraq and Iran in the mountains beyond. Babylon would have been one of the major cities. But we don't know where they came from. Whether they came from Arabia or Persia or Mesopotamia is uncertain. When the star appeared, it caught their attention. And somehow they associated the star's appearance with the birth of the Jewish king, the Messiah, the one who was worthy of worship. About that star, speculations abound as to what natural, explainable phenomenon could have produced an unusually and sufficiently brilliant celestial object just at that time in history in order to catch the Magi's attention. Astronomers have calculated that Halley's Comet would have been visible in 11 BC, 11 years before Christ. And Jupiter and Saturn came together brightly in 7 BC before Christ. Others speculate it was an actual star, which is a hot ball of gases, or maybe a comet, or a supernova event, or maybe even a bright meteor. But as John MacArthur says, they're just that, speculations. How could we think of the star from the perspective of Scripture? Luke 2, verses 8 and 9 tells us that at Christ's birth, in the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. So on the night of Jesus' birth, two things suddenly appeared to the shepherds: an angel and the glory of the Lord. Angels are sometimes described in Scripture as shining beings or beings dressed in shining garments. But the glory of the Lord is the light that comes from God Himself. God is light. It is His very essence. It's as if on the night of Christ's birth, a portal was opened in the sky, and the light that permeates heaven from God's presence and His essence burst through in blinding brilliance. No wonder the shepherds were terrified. John MacArthur says the Hebrew word for what is translated into English as star can also be interpreted as a blazing or a shining forth. And it's used that way in other scriptures. I think, and it's a supposition only, that the Magi stargazers in the east could have seen that same glory of the Lord that shone down on the shepherds. On any night, there is a full moon. Because it is so high in the sky, people across different and distant countries can see the same moon at the same time. And I'm supposed that if what I'm suggesting as an idea were the case, that this opening in the heavens that permitted the glory of the Lord to shine down on the shepherds would have been from a much higher place than the moon. And they probably could have seen it. Now, many of our popular songs talk about the Magi following the star on their journey from the east to Jerusalem as if they needed some kind of celestial GPS. But Scripture here says they saw His star in the east, past tense, and came to worship Him. Having seen the star and interpreting its significance from what they had of Jewish scriptures, they knew where to go: Jerusalem, which is the royal city of the Jews in Judea. When they arrived there in Matthew, as Matthew says in 2:9, after hearing King Herod, they went their way, and the star which they had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over where the child was. A comet or a conjunction of planets or even a physical hot star under normal conditions of physical laws doesn't reappear and move and then stop, as did the one the Magi saw. Additionally, in verse 10, when they saw the star at that time, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. It's as if they hadn't seen it since it appeared to them in the east. And now, as they approached their intended destination, suddenly it reappears, confirming their trip and guiding them to the specific place. But you know, in the end, Scripture doesn't explain the star. And speculation will surely not end here, even after my poor suggestions. But the appearance of this unusual star is consistent with God's intervening in history, as is recorded in Scripture. He sometimes does things that can't be explained by human logic or invention. Verse 2, the Magi came saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews?" Born king of the Jews, was an honored designation distinct from King Herod, who had been appointed king by the Romans, a foreign power. Born king, always king. Appointed king, possible to be unappointed, dethroned. For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. Where might the Magi from the east have acquired the ancient writings about the appearance of an unusual star that could be connected to the birth of the King of the Jews? There is a prophecy that refers to a star and a scepter, a sign of the coming King of the Jews in the Pentateuch, which are the five books of Moses. It was pronounced just before the Israelites crossed the Jordan River and entered the Promised Land in 1406 BC before Christ. That's 1,400 years before Christ. The Israelites were camped outside the land of Canaan on the east side of the Jordan River, getting ready to go in. They had already defeated two kings on that side of the Jordan: Sihon, king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan. The next country up the road was Moab. Balak, king of Moab, had heard what happened to the Amorites and to Bashan, and of course was alarmed. So he sent for a Gentile prophet named Balaam of Beor to curse the Israelites. Balaam was a non-Israelite. He was a diviner. He was a shaman. He was a priest, you could say. He was a Gentile, and yet somehow he had knowledge of the true God, Jehovah. God didn't permit Balaam to curse the Israelites. Instead, he blessed them. And in that blessing, which he called an oracle of Balaam, he prophesied, "I shall see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not nigh. There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall arise out of Israel." In Numbers 24:17, the star is the sign, and the scepter refers to the king. This came to be known as one of the messianic prophecies. Needless to say, Balaam's blessing the Israelites instead of cursing them didn't go well with Balak, the Moab king, who had hired him to curse them, so he dismissed Balaam. But the prophecy was pronounced, and it was of God, and it was true. And Moses recorded it in his writing of the five books of the Pentateuch. So how could the Magi have received and known of this prophecy? The Bible doesn't tell us this detail. But from the Bible, we do know that years later, in 605 BC, before Christ, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, captured Jerusalem and carried a large part of the Jews in exile to Babylon. A young man, Daniel, was among those captives. And Daniel was immersed in the Jewish scriptures, and he possessed a strong faith in the God of heaven that the Jews worshiped. Because of his faith and because of special favor that God granted him, he found favor in the eyes of King Nebuchadnezzar. And Daniel 2:46 and 49 tells us that King Nebuchadnezzar promoted Daniel and made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief prefect over all the wise men of Babylon. Chief prefect, according to dictionary.com, is a person appointed to any of various positions of command, authority, or superintendence. Could be a chief magistrate or the chief administrative official of some department in France or Italy or Spain. Chief prefect. Daniel was in exile in Babylon for 70 years. He served under the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar, under Nebuchadnezzar's son Belshazzar, and then under Darius, king of the Medes. No doubt, in his lengthy tenure and position as chief prefect over all the wise men of Babylon, Daniel introduced to them and taught them, perhaps, the Jewish scriptures, among which were Moses' five books of the Pentateuch and this prophecy. And although the birth of Christ was some 600 years later, the learned men of Babylon could have preserved those scriptures and known of the prophecies of the star and the birth of the Jewish king and Messiah. Verse 2b continues, "And we have come to worship him." This, perhaps, is the most remarkable statement in this story, especially coming from Gentiles from a distant land. They were pagans, and yet they still had a true and sincere desire to seek God. And they came with no other stated motive but this. I think they truly exemplified what Paul described as the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. Verse 3, "When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him." When report of the Magi's arrival and their search for this newborn king was brought to Herod, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. To Herod, considered by some to be an illegitimate king, the news of one born king of the Jews would seem a threat to his throne. The members of Herod's court and all Jerusalem had reason to be troubled with him. He had previously murdered one of his wives, Mariamne, and two of his own sons for perceived threats to his position. What could he be capable of doing in light of this new development? Herod, gathering all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for this is what has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the leaders of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler, forth a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Remarkably, Herod interpreted correctly the news of the birth of this new king to be that of the long-awaited and promised Messiah. So he asked where the Messiah was to be born. All of Israel longed for the coming of the Messiah, so any announcement of his birth would have created no small stir. But like most Jewish people, Herod probably thought of the Messiah as a military political leader. He must surely have been aware that to recognize, receive, and accept the promised Messiah would mean giving up his own throne in preference to him. He did not know or understand the real purpose of Christ's coming, that as the Lamb of God who would take away the sin of the world. The chief priests and scribes knew the Old Testament scriptures and the prophecy of the Messiah's birth. Well, why didn't they go to Bethlehem to see the fulfillment of the prophecy? Why didn't they go the 5 miles to nearby Bethlehem to see, acknowledge, receive, and worship the newborn king, their long-awaited Messiah? They were probably content with the status quo and their privileged positions. They were perhaps burdened with complacency and possibly disbelief. They could have thought, how is it possible that the sign of the birth of the Messiah could be given to someone else besides us, especially to these pagan Gentiles? So they disregarded and discarded the report. If the sign of the star didn't appear to them, then for all practical purposes, it didn't happen. This, unfortunately, was the mindset of the Jews. They were the chosen people of God. The rest of the world, the Gentiles, the non-Jews, were simply the outsiders. When Jesus entered the synagogue in his own hometown of Nazareth, he said, as is recorded in Luke 4, "Truly I say to you, no prophet is welcome in his hometown. But I say to you in truth, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the sky was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, when a great famine came over all the land. And yet Elijah was sent to none of them, but only to Zarephath in the land of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And there were many lepers in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. And all the people in the synagogue were filled with rage as they heard these things, and they got up and drove him out of the city and led him to the brow of the hill on which their city had been built, in order to throw him down the cliff. But passing through their midst, he went his way." When Jesus recounted these two occasions recorded in their Jewish Old Testament scriptures of God ministering to Gentiles instead of to Jews, it enraged his hearers. Their response typified the attitude of the Jews toward the pagan Gentiles. But additionally, and most surely, the chief priests and scribes were fearful of being perceived as traitors to Herod. If they dared acknowledge the report of the Magi and went themselves to see and worship the Christ child, Herod would have their heads. So, of course, they and all Jerusalem were troubled with him. We might ask, did they not see the star? I don't think so. Oh, it did appear, but God withheld it from them. When Jesus denounced the cities in which most of his miracles were done because they did not repent, he said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for this way was well-pleasing in your sight." The priests and the scribes were wise in the scriptures. They knew the prophecies. But in their self-confidence and comfort and complacency and lack of courage and faith, they missed it. They didn't put the dots together. We must be careful not to be Christians full of knowledge, but lacking in belief and faith. It was a telling indictment against the ruling Jewish religious establishment of Jesus' time. Even from Jesus' birth, he came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. Later, the chief priests and scribes opposed Jesus during all of his public ministry, and they were the ones who ultimately conspired to have him crucified. The next verse in John continues, "But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name." The Magi sought and received Christ. If the ancient prophecy inspired by God and spoken by Balaam, the pagan Gentile priest, was what led the Magi to the Christ child, then it seems appropriate that God would also reveal the glory of Christ's birth to these pagans like the Magi who would receive and heed it. Verses 7 and 8. Herod secretly inquires of the Magi to determine the exact time the star appeared to them, presuming the star's appearance coincided with the baby's birth. He then sent them to Bethlehem to search diligently for the child and instructed them to report back to him after finding the child so that he himself could worship him, concealing his true intentions to eliminate the child. Verses 9 and 10, after hearing the king, they went their way, and the star which they had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. Notice the past tense in reference to the star which they had seen in the east. Notice the movement and then the stopping of the star. Notice the exhilarating joy with which they rejoiced on seeing the star again. Notice that they came in verse 11 into the house and not the manger. Notice that they fell to the ground and worshiped him. Notice their posture, face down in a prone position to indicate worship. Their posture of worship was to place themselves in a position lower than his. When Chinese people toast with their glasses at a meal, in a curious and sometimes subtle gesture to honor the other and express their own humility, they will touch their glasses to the other's glass so that the rim of their glass is below or lower than the rim of the other. The Magi fell to the ground and worshiped him. Worship is ascribing worth. Worship of the newborn king was the purpose and goal of their trip. Christ the Lord, the Messiah, was and is worthy of all worship. Jesus, the Christ child, was worthy of the star, the blazing, brilliant, blazing forth announcement from heaven of his birth. Christ was worthy of God's faithfulness in the prophecy fulfilled. He was worthy of the Gentile Magi's trust in Scripture. He was worthy of their response of faith to the appearance of the star. He was worthy of their abandonment of their homes and families and of their decision and determination to take the trip. He was worthy of their commitment to see it through. He was worthy of their facing danger and risk. He was worthy of their worship. Verse 11b says, then opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The Christ child was worthy of the Magi's gifts, each one of great value, as well as being portable. The gifts, it turns out to be, were God's provision for the young couple's and the child's needs. In verse 12, God intervenes and warns the Magi in a dream not to return to Herod. And after they leave to return to their own country, that's the last we hear of them in Scripture. But their visit to worship the Christ child was like a rock thrown into a quiet pool of water, and the concentric waves continued moving out from the impact. Verses 11 and 15, immediately, an angel of the Lord tells Joseph in a dream to take the child and his mother and to flee to Egypt with the warning that Herod was going to search for the child to destroy him. And Joseph immediately obeys while it was still night and left for Egypt. The prophecy that Matthew mentions out of Hosea recalls that God formed the Hebrew nation of Israel in Egypt and that Israel was his son. Verse 16, Herod reveals his true character and his true intentions. When he saw that the Magi didn't return to his courts, he became very enraged and slew all the male children who were in Bethlehem and all its vicinity from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the Magi. History calls it the slaughter of the innocents. And we are horrified at the memory. When God is working out his plans, there is often great opposition. And this was but one of Satan's attempts to thwart God's plan to save the world through the incarnation of his son. But God is still on the throne, and his purposes cannot be thwarted. Not long after that, Herod himself died, and God, through an angel in a dream, sent from Egypt for Joseph to bring the child and his mother back to Israel, where he would grow up and minister and die for the sins of the world. God's purpose has always been to redeem all of mankind, Jews and Gentiles. Christ was born for you, for me, and for all of mankind. Have you repented of sin, believed, and received him as your Lord and Savior? Today, at the beginning of a new year, is the day to do just that. It is too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also make you a light of the nations, so that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Who in this story do you identify with the most? The Magi. God revealed himself to the Magi who saw his star in the east, and they interpreted the sign in light of prophecy in Scripture and responded to that vision in faith and set out to worship him. And they kept going until they saw the star again just when they needed it. Or Herod. The news came to Herod, who also had the opportunity to accept and receive the long-promised Messiah and thus lead all of the Jews in worship of the newborn king. But he succumbed to his own selfish paranoia and determination to perpetuate his throne against all perceived threats. Then there were the Jewish chief priests and scribes, who knew the scriptures and who knew the prophecies of the Messiah's birth and were waiting for the Messiah. But they didn't add to their knowledge faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Who do you identify with in the story? This story gives us few details about the Magi. But their worship of the Christ child exemplifies what Paul spoke of in 2 Corinthians, the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him. May that describe each and every one of us as well as we conclude the 2021 Christmas season and enter the new year of 2022.
Please join us as we sing "Here I Am to Worship."
You came as a child, yet a king. You were born as a child, yet a savior. You came to save us. You born as a child, yet a shepherd. And we thank you so much for your great sacrifice you did for us. So our heart rejoice, as Paul said in Philippians, rejoice in the Lord always. Said it again, rejoice. And let your gentleness be evidence to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but everything with prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Please join us as we sing the closing song.
Come on.
hope to have you again with us next week. Thank you, and Happy New Year.